The Plausible Impossible is one of the more famous Disneyland shows because it revealed, for the first time in public, a sequence from Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs that was cut from the film after it was completed in pencil form. But what makes it even more special is the context in which Walt presents this gem.
And now, The Plausible Impossible has brought out in the unfinished sequence that was made for Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
He explains how the painful decision was made and shows us how, even bereft of color, the pure, unadulterated work of the animator can still shine through. He even shows us how the rudimentary backgrounds for the scene were prepared in pencil, demonstrating the light box on an animator's desk. I ate all this up when I was a kid, and it still enchants me today. But I can tell you what I loved even more. A sequence of Donald Duck running loose on Walt's desk and even talking back to his boss.
Donald, the people are waiting.
Wonderful stuff, along with some brand new animation of Mickey Mouse designed to illustrate some of the special properties of the cartoon medium.
Here's a different impossibility. First is the idea that Mickey won't fall until he realizes he is only standing on thin air. And second, if he scrambles hard enough, he might get sufficient traction in the air to get back to safety.
Even Walt's explanation of music and its relation to animation is enlightening, as he shows us different ways Mussorgsky's Night on Bald Mountain might have been put to use. This show, like its predecessor, was written by animation veteran Dick Humer, and its animation sequences were directed by another Disney stalwart, Wilfred Jackson.
Disney's Disneyland.
When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are.
Each week as you enter this timeless land, one of these many worlds will open to you. Frontierland. Tall tales and true from the legendary past. Tomorrowland, promise of things to come. Adventureland, the wonder world of nature's own realm. Fantasyland, the happiest kingdom of them all. Presenting this week, The Plausible Impossible. And now, your host, Walt Disney.
These animation drawings are from a part of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs that was never seen by the public. These are just a few of the drawings out of an entire episode that was not used in the picture. And this is a scene from one of the musical numbers in Fantasia called A Night on Bald Mountain. This film portrays a medieval superstition that grew into our modern conception of Halloween. Later on, you'll see both of these sequences. They will illustrate the principle in animation, which we call the plausible impossible. The plausible impossible means taking something that is against the laws of nature, something impossible, and making it appear rational and acceptable. In short, plausible. I'm quoting from our book, The Art of Animation. Herein, we have tried to answer the questions of not only those who are merely curious about animation, but also those serious students who wish to go deeper into the subject. One entire chapter is devoted to the plausible impossible. First, you must understand the plausible impossible is not something we, who draw animated cartoons, invented. It's been around a long time. Looking back into history, we find many examples in art and literature of things that are impossible, yet they were plausible and acceptable in their time. These Egyptian figures, each with a human body, but with the head of a lion, jackal, or a bird, might seem merely fanciful to us, even amusing. But to the ancient Egyptians, they were quite real and believable because they were gods, supernatural beings. To the ancient Chinese, the dragon was very real, even though no one had actually seen one that looked like this. Yet there may be a very plausible basis for their belief in dragons. It is an established fact that monstrous creatures roamed the earth in prehistoric times. Dinosaurs somewhere overlapped with man's earliest beginnings, and the memory of these monsters may have been passed on from generation to generation to finally evolve into the Chinese conception of the dragon. Greek mythology has many strange characters too. Impossible though they look, they are not hard to justify. For instance, the idea of the centaur could well have been the simple case of mistaken identity. The ancient Greeks were accustomed to seeing horses pulling chariots. They'd been doing it for centuries. It was not until about 1200 BC that someone got the strange idea of riding on horseback. Seeing a horse and a man together in this manner for the first time must have been quite a shock. And the myth of the centaur may well have been created later on in a too enthusiastic retelling of the incident. So much for the ancient history of the plausible impossible. Now let's see how it applies to the animated cartoon. Impossible cartoon actions will seem plausible if the viewer feels the action he is watching has some factual basis. For example, the idea that pulling a cow's tail could ring a bell hanging on her neck may seem far-fetched, but it has some basis in fact. There is an anatomical connection between the bell here and the tail here. That is the spinal column. And so it seems entirely plausible that pulling her tail would ring the bell. Factor in making cartoon action believable is correctness of sensation. When an elevator starts up suddenly, we feel as though our bodies actually squash. So in our cartoon, Mickey's body really does squash and stretch. Now, let's take Mickey to the mountains on a windy day. Here's a different impossibility. It's based on two plausibilities, one psychological, the other physical. First is the idea that Mickey won't fall until he realizes he is only standing on thin air. And second, if he scrambles hard enough, he might get sufficient traction in the air to get back to safety. And here, the principle of momentum is involved. If Mickey builds up enough speed, it seems quite plausible for him to keep right on climbing even after he has come to the end of his rope. And finally, on the baseball diamond with Mickey on the pitcher's mound. When he winds up to throw the ball, if his action is vigorous enough, it might very plausibly take him up into the air, like a helicopter. Now, here's another side of the plausible impossible. It's been used so extensively in animated cartoons as to be almost taken for granted, impossible though it is. This is a trick of giving life to inanimate objects. Now, by their very nature, it's impossible for inanimate things to have life. Yet a good many years ago, we made a picture in which I think you'll find many plausibly alive objects. This picture was based on Lewis Carroll's famous book, Through the Looking Glass. We took many liberties in this film, including substituting Mickey Mouse in the role of Alice. Like Alice, Mickey Mouse found himself in a topsy-turvy land where the laws of nature were suspended and anything could happen. In animated cartoons, there's nothing quite so important for the characters themselves as being plausible. Their problem is that they are not real individuals. They must be created step by step. Each and every animated cartoon character starts out as a blank piece of paper, which is drawn upon by a pencil. Oh, by the way, this pencil you are watching is in itself a plausible impossibility. Animation gives movement, which in turn gives life to the drawing. But equally as important as animation is sound. Sound helps to give the character plausibility in two ways. First, by giving him an appropriate voice.
Oh, that's very, very cool.
Second, we must have convincing sound effects. And now, Donald, would you mind helping with a demonstration?
Oh, sure. I'd be glad to.
No, no, Donald. Let's do the sound effects first.
Okay, what do I do?
Take off your hat and face the audience.
Like this?
That's fine. Now, we all know that a head isn't really hollow, but it is this idea which lends plausibility to a sound like this. Also, we know that a head can't sound like a gong, but a heavy enough instrument can really make your head ring. Now you take a real heavy object, say something weighing 3 or 4 tons. This can produce some very plausible effects, both audible and visual. First, the sound, which was made by letting a steel tank drop 10 feet onto the concrete floor of an empty swimming pool, with reverberation added. Now, let's run the film back and hear that interesting sound again. And now let's observe the pictorial result of our experiment. This visual accordion effect naturally demands an accordion sound. Now here's an unusual effect. When a character is shot out of a cannon, okay, Donald, forget the cannon. We're all through with the sound effects. Come on out.
No, sir. Get me out of it.
Oh, come on, Donald. You'll enjoy this next demonstration.
No. Absolutely not.
Donald, the people are waiting.
Let them wait.
Okay, Donald. I guess we'll just have to go ahead without you. Now, next, we'll have a dining room table full of lots of good things to eat. First, a steaming bowl of soup full of succulent fresh garden vegetables. Next, some French peas, sweet, tender, and drenched with butter. And corn on the cob, cold cuts of meat, spaghetti, French bread, donuts, coffee. And finally, for dessert, a chocolate cake that melts in your mouth, marshmallow in the layers, coconut on top, and a cherry. Actually, it would be impossible for any one person to eat all this.
Watch me.
And since Donald absolutely refuses to demonstrate how this can be plausibly achieved, we'll just have to find somebody else.
Oh, never mind, Bart. I'm inclined to do it.
So we'll call on Donald's cousin, Gus Goose. And now, the plausible impossible has brought out in the unfinished sequence that was made for Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. While this animation was still in the preliminary or pencil phase, we found that the overall picture was too long. Something had to be left out, and this was it. You see, even though we liked the sequence, it was not essential to the telling of the story. So when you look at this sequence, it won't look like the picture as you remember seeing it in the theater. Instead, you will see the animator's original pencil drawings. These were photographed over simple outline sketches of the background and will look like this. But before we see the unfinished sequence, let's look at a few scenes that led up to it. These, of course, are from the final finished version of the picture, in which all the action was traced on celluloids, painted in color, and photographed over full-tone backgrounds. As you remember, Snow White's wicked stepmother, the Queen, jealous of the girl's beauty, had attempted to do away with her. Here, Snow White has found refuge in the cottage of the Seven Dwarfs. Patient.
With a spoon, with a bowl, with the music in your soul, you can cheer things up with the zup, zup, zup of the music in your soup. With a gulp, with a grin, get a wiggle on your chin. You can make things hum with the zum, zum, zum of the music in your soup.
Swing that spoon, gotta keep on dipping. Scoop that soup, gotta keep on sipping. And the bowl is dry and your face is dripping. Let her rip, let her roar. To a first and a second and a third encore.
Natural.
Anybody can do it.
With practice.
Yes, but you don't understand. This is the way gentlemen eat soup.
Gentlemen?
Yes. Now watch. Spoon in the hand, bending the wrist, into the bowl, and out with a twist.
Spoon in the hand, bending the wrist, into the bowl, and out with a twist.
That's fine. That's perfect.
Perfect?
What's the matter with Dopey?
He swallowed his spoon.
Hey, get him!
I got him!
Pickle!
There! Now we got him.
Open his mouth. I'll get it. Say ah.
There he is!
I got it!
no, no, that'll never work. Turn him upside down. Snake it, shake it out.
Here, I'll get it. Bend him over. That's it.
Bam.
Ready?
Ready.
Clear the way.
Now here's a more serious side of the plausible impossible. It concerns music. We all know it's impossible to see music, yet many composers have tried to take musical sounds and give them a pictorial meaning. This is known as program music. It is meant to describe a certain picture or tell a definite story. Here's an example of program music written by the great Russian composer Modest Mussorgsky. Let's take this characteristic theme, carried principally by the trombones and tubas. No one would question that this theme suggests power. But when Mussorgsky wrote it, he wasn't thinking in general terms. He had a specific picture in mind, and he intended his music to convey that same picture to the listener. Now, to do this is impossible because music is an arbitrary art form and exists only as sound. So regardless of what Mussorgsky had in mind, his musical theme is equally descriptive of a wide variety of scenes. For instance, it might picture the power of magic as shown in a scene from our cartoon feature, Fantasia.
This has been an ABC Television Network film presentation.